See, that's how I like it. You can do the barefoot interview.
How did this non-marriage marriage begin?
The two of us, Rick and I, have been working in war zones for more than a decade together. I started going to Iraq in the mid-90s when I was just sort of a brand new reporter. I was like a coffee runner for this journalist named Amy Goodman and got this chance to go to Iraq with a humanitarian delegation that was going in the late 90s. And from there on, I sort of caught the bug for doing, you know, war reporting. And Rick's wife's also a journalist, and the three of us worked together in various places, and we experienced the Iraq War together. And, you know, when you go through something intense like a war, you know, you really get close to the people that are around you. And so coming out of that, we started collaborating on some projects. And then as the Bush administration transformed into the Obama administration and the war in Afghanistan continued on, we were following this one story about how there was sort of a war within the war. And there were these night raids happening that you would only sort of hear about in press releases. Three Taliban killed, two detained for questioning. There were never names on them. So we decided to go and look at this sort of war within the war in Afghanistan. And we stumbled upon a night raid gone wrong in this village called Gardez, which was way outside of the green zone, where some U.S. commandos had come in, and they raided a house that they thought was a Taliban stronghold. And they end up killing five people, three women and two men. Mm-hmm. One of the men turned out to be a senior Afghan police commander, and two of the women were pregnant women. So you have these U.S. commandos, they realize that they've screwed up, they're in this house, and instead of just sort of owning it, they dig the bullets out of the women's bodies. And then they blame it, they issue a press release blaming it on a Taliban honor killing. They said their own families had murdered them. So we started with this one sort of mystery, and we were pulling on the elephant's tail behind, you know, the wall, and realized there's this behemoth there, because the people that did the killings those days and covered it up were in fact members of the Joint Special Operations Command, this elite unit that is essentially a paramilitary arm of whichever president is in power. Mm-hmm. And as we realized that it was this unit, and we started following them, we ended up in Yemen and Somalia, and the film we thought we were going to make became a totally different one. And when our world was turned upside down was when in early May, President Obama walks up to a podium and announces that Osama bin Laden has been killed. And the very units that killed Osama bin Laden were the ones we had been tracking that had killed these women in Gardez. And it was sort of this like holy shit moment. Like, and so, you know, our film went through like three different lives, and so what ended up coming to Sundance was much more intense and very different and actually quite personal in a way. I've never been a person on camera. That's not what I do. Mm-hmm. But in telling the story, we realized that both Rick and I had changed in the course of doing this. And the bin Laden raid was really sort of this looking glass moment for us.
So when you started pulling on the tail, did you assume that there was something bigger on the other side of the wall that you didn't know about? Or, I mean, was there a chance that it might just be a dead end or that...
Well, I mean,
tell the truth.
We knew that something was going on because, I mean, I'd been embedded in Afghanistan. I'd made like four or five different reporting trips and been, you know, all over the country. And, you know, when you embed with the conventional forces, they'll take you around. They'll show them, you know, give you photo ops of them digging wells or like drinking tea with tribal elders and, you know, going on presence patrols where they just try to get shot at so they can have someone to return fire to. But all of the action was happening in the shadows. Like, all of it was hidden from us. We would get press releases that would list, you know, killed, captured Taliban, but no one could tell us anything about it. So we knew that there was a story there. And when we went to Gardez, I mean, all we had were these, just a few clues. We had a photograph of the commander of this force who, when he came, eventually when the story broke, the unit was forced to come and apologize. And a photographer was there who took a picture of Vice Admiral William McRaven, who at that time no one knew who he was. And he certainly wasn't from the NATO forces that in Afghanistan. He wasn't from the regional command there. Mm-hmm. We had a photo of him, and we have this cell phone video that the someone in the family took of the night after the raid, where you hear the voices of the Americans, you see their hands, but you can't see their faces. So we had just these
which plays like a horror movie. I mean, it's almost like kind of fascinating to watch that.
Too. Yeah, yeah. So it really spun out like a mystery story, like with one, you know, these few little pieces of evidence. You know, following them led us. I mean, you know, so we never thought in Afghanistan that we would end up, the story would take us to Somalia or Yemen, to places that are far off of any stated battlefield. And we certainly never thought that when we were talking to Afghan victims of night raids that we would end up talking to families of Americans who were killed by these same forces.
So what is the mindset of journalists over there in general? I mean, it's been an interesting, it's now been a long time, but, you know, a lot of the guys who did the early Iraqi documentaries, kind of have a combination of shell shock and a certain amount of anger at other people doing documentaries that they feel aren't quite as in-depth or valuable? Is there a sense of being in a unique brand of journalism by being over there at all?
I think, you know, I think a lot of journalists, you know, you try to engage in this farce that you're objective, that you're somehow not part of the story. And you know, the world of combat journalism is just a trail of shattered lives, you know, and we certainly experience that together. It's part of why we're so close. You know, when Rick and I travel to these countries, even if like a hotel room is $2, we stay in the same room together. I mean, we've become really like family in shooting this. And we know other journalists. You have this community of people, and you're like, oh, I knew you from Bosnia, or I knew you from, you know, whatever, Kosovo and Iraq. And you see these people around the world, and it's sort of like a family, but everyone has these kind of hollowed out eyes after 10 years of this stuff. And it really takes a toll on you. And, you know, I mentioned earlier that, you know, that this project had changed us. And I think a lot of journalists will relate to this film. You know, we have a scene where we've come home from Afghanistan, and you know, and I say that, you know, coming home is never easy. You know, ordinary life is just that. Mm-hmm. And it's true, you know, your own family starts to become the foreigner to you, and where you feel at home is when you're around things exploding and people dying, and it's a totally unhealthy way to walk around the earth. And so that's also a part of this film. You know, we it's not just about our journalism. We also tell the story of other journalists who were being attacked for their reporting, a journalist who was put in jail in Yemen for exposing a missile strike. And, you know, this isn't a journalist movie, but it definitely has that at its heart. And I think a lot of media people, whether they've been in combat or not, will relate to the struggles and feelings of isolation and loneliness. And also just that you don't process it. You know, you're taught to be tough, especially if you're in these things. You have to be able to look at a dead body and not break down sobbing. That's not normal. That's not a normal reaction. And so, you know, part of what we tried to do also was to humanize the victims, even in death, in our film. You know, we don't want to show war porn. You know, we try to preserve some sense of dignity. But at the end, if you don't recognize your own humanity as a journalist, then you've kind of stopped being a human being, and you're some kind of a robot. And eventually it's going to catch up with you.
Mm. Yeah. And you have a 2-month-old. It is.
Yeah.
Child. So you and your wife is involved with this as well.
Yeah. My wife is more badass than I am. Yeah, she was in, you know, Afghanistan in 2001. She was with Jeremy in Iraq, like as the, you know, in the weeks before the bombs started falling. She's an amazing woman. She was part of conceiving and filming this project at the beginning, but when the Arab Spring happened, she was stolen from us by HBO and went over and made a film in Tahrir Square about the revolution in Egypt.
Their daughter is our gaffer, though. She's credited. Her name, Layla Honeysuckle. She's the gaffer on our film.
Well, I mean, are you now? Does your head now come out of the rabbit hole and you guys have a real life for a while and not do this for a while as a
Sundance is surreal. I can't say that I've seen a hot tub in the past few years. You know, I've seen a lot of hot other things, but I've never seen a hot tub. You know, it's funny. Another a critic was talking to me the other night from a big newspaper. We were chatting, and she said, you know, in the film you seem so serious, but you know, this whole dinner you're smiling and laughing. And I'm like, yeah, because we feel relieved, like we can actually be normal people again. And you know, it's been nice to meet other filmmakers too. Like we're psyched to be with all of these folks, especially in the documentary competition. We don't view it as a competition. We've been scrambling to get tickets to other people's movies and. We've hung out with the stars, I guess you could call them, of Manhunt, which is kind of funny because my Twitter followers are kind of like, what are you doing hanging out with like CIA people, man? Yeah. But like they all came to our party and they hung out with us, and it's been a great experience here. And there's a common experience I think that spooks and journalists share, if not in worldview, then definitely in sort of being in hot zones. And it's a little surreal to be like hanging out with some of the people that caught Bin Laden at this festival and to like be just having a drink with them. It's kind of strange.
Well, we think, I mean, journalists and critics and everybody here at the festival kind of think we're writing about the real world, and we realize that movies are movies. I mean, they're important. They have a significance in the culture and everything else, but you know, you guys are actually in the shit, as it were. I mean, it's like a general in Washington talking about Vietnam and then somebody who was actually fighting in Vietnam. It's a little different perspective.
Mm-hmm. Although Hollywood can be a little bit like a war zone for you guys. I mean, you could be from the front lines to the front row, and you can.
Yeah, it's but a you different know, you ultimately end up at the Ivy either way. So it's, you know, somebody's going to bring the check, and somebody's going to pick it up, and probably the studio. So
there's some amazing documentaries here this year. It's like an incredible batch, and I think one of the things that I think is interesting about them and about our film too is that they're. I mean, it seems like a shame to call them documentaries. I mean, because it makes it sound like they're, you know, they're just stenography or archivists or something, when they're really, they're narrative nonfiction. They're like strong narrative arcs. They have all that commitment to the facts and the reality and the truth, but all of the sort of depth and emotional power of fictional narratives. So it's an amazing group of films to be part of.
Well, I think this year particularly is the kind of the year of narrowcasting, is that I think a lot of the filmmakers, for whatever reasons, decided to figure out what their subject was and not make it about the entire history of that subject, but really focus on one thing, one person, one idea. And it's been, I'm a big believer in the communal idea of documentary now, in this era of, you know, the smaller cameras and everything, that people are out, you know, it takes five documentaries to tell one story. No matter how good one documentarian is, they're all a piece of the puzzle that adds up into one thing.
Also, I mean, I think, you know, so-called reality television has presented a lot of challenges for sort of verite film in a sense, because, you know, Americans are used to seeing, you know, the Real Housewives and their Pinot Grigio fests and all this stuff, and you can tell if a scene is staged there. And America, you know, people are much more in tune to what's real and what's BS. I mean, you can make an argument that whole thing is BS. But so I think it actually presents a challenge that results in a lot more creativity, because you have a smarter, I really do think that you have a smarter audience now because of some of this really bad television. And their bullshit radar is tuned much, you know, with much more of a focus. And so, you know, when we were setting out to make this film, and we didn't know what we were doing, the one thing we said we didn't want to do is have it look like some faked, you know, bad trip from one of the Housewives or some other show, Sunset Hills or whatever those shows are called, which I don't actually like them. I actually do like them, but so that was what we were. That's what we were playing with.
So you're gonna be on Bravo next. We're setting up the Bravo shoot.
Andy. This may ruin my street cred, but I do have on my phone pictures of me with Tim Gunn, you know, the host from Project Runway, who I met in an airport and went up to him. And I told him, I was talking to him, and he said, "Well, you know, what do you do?" And I told him, and he goes, "Oh my!" he kind of did like a pullback from me. So. Anyway,
I'm looking forward to seeing you as a guest judge on Project Runway. I think that'll be happening.
If they'd have me, man, I'd love it.
They could do, Afghani style will be your the special topic that week. And
War Reporter Chic, man, it's coming.
War Reporter Chic. <Yeah. laughs> Is there such a thing? Do you guys have a look? Is there a...
Well, I mean, actually, there is a scene in the film where Jeremy, the clothes are made for Jeremy. Like, as we go, when we disembed and we leave the green zone cover this night raid, I mean, we go into the market and have to get other clothes, because the only way for us to really work safely there is to try to go under the radar. Mm. We can't have any security, so we dress in local clothes, travel with just two people and a translator, me, Jeremy, and a translator, drive in, you know, unmarked, beat up old Toyotas, and push as far as we can outside of the zone. So, yeah, I mean, actually, we do have to, you know.
Did you have a beard before? Have you shaved your beard?
I had a large beard for a while.
You know what's funny? When we first went into Afghanistan together, we were in the country for maybe an hour. We were pulling out of the airport. We'd gone through security, and we're driving out, and I was in the back seat. We had a driver. Rick's in the front seat, and Rick had this huge beard. And the Afghan police, you know, they're like pulling us over, and we didn't know what it was. And they're looking in, and they're looking at Rick, and they said to the driver, "Is he in the Taliban?" They actually thought Rick was like, and they thought he was like an Uzbek.
Yeah,
everywhere we went, they're like, "Oh, Uzbek."
Going for.
Yeah. No, you can go too far, like in that direction. I was arrested by Iraqi police once for being an Iranian spy, because I was trying to look not like an American, and I apparently went like two steps too far in that direction. I was actually then rescued by. There was a fight between the Iraqi police and the Iraqi army, so the Iraqi army heard the radio chatter of a detained Iranian who claimed to be American, and they rolled in with like heavy machinery to like pull me out. Anyway,
there's this total gangster in our film who's he's from Somalia, this guy named Mohammed Kanyare, and you know, he appears briefly in the film, and he's sort of talking about how the Americans taught them war. You know, it's sort of ironic. This guy's saying the Americans are teachers, great teachers. But, you know, sometimes you can't put the backstory into a film. You don't want it to be a kitchen sink film. But the way we got this guy on camera is that I had heard that he went to the gym at this hotel in Nairobi, Kenya, where a lot of these warlords from Somalia hang out. That the hotel was owned by Muammar Gaddafi at the time. So I staked him out, and I went up to him as he was coming out of the gym. And I went up to him and said that I was a journalist and I wanted to talk to him. And he ended up sitting down for tea with me. And he insisted, and I think he still believes it to this day, that I was a spy. And that I was in CIA, and because he was talking to me as though he was going for another job interview. Mm-hmm. And that happened to us in Somalia constantly. Everyone thought Rick and I were in the CIA, which, you know, I don't know whether it's an insult or to take it as a compliment, but we had really bizarre experiences that, you know, are sort of, maybe they'll be on the DVD extras or something.
Any journalists that you think are in the CIA? Or you?
I mean, there has been a tradition of that. What I think is disturbing is that we know from declassified documents that there were plans, including under the Obama administration, to have journalists who traveled in some of these areas provide information to U.S. intelligence. And that's been a tradition for a long time. And I think it really makes the job of other journalists dangerous, because there's already a perception, mm-hmm. as I'm sure you're aware, in these countries that, you know, everyone is a spy. Yeah, I mean, I think there's a two-edged sword. I think some journalists do collude with U.S. intelligence and give mm-hmm. them information. And then I think others are sort of gone after or attacked, for getting too close to a sensitive story. But, you know, none of the journalists that I know and respect, and never in a million years could imagine them doing that. I'm not saying it doesn't happen, but I don't know. I'd be very disturbing if it was true.
For me, one of the sticky things about the film is the image of you coming back and doing talk shows and things like that, and having other people tell you how crazy you are. And just that look on your face of, oh, God, like, you know, you don't know what you're talking about. But you seem to be polite about it. Is journalism doing its job overall? I mean, you guys are out there fighting the fight. There are a lot of other people doing it very sincerely. But are we at a point where journalism is capable of telling this story properly on a consistent basis?
Go ahead.
Well, I mean, I think there's two sort of things going on. I mean, there are amazing journalists out there who risk their lives and do incredible reporting. And some of them work for the New York Times, and some of them are people who you'll never hear about. I mean, the bravest journalists we know are actually, you know, Afghans or Yemenis or Somalis or Iraqis who are risking their lives every day and we'll never know their names. But another thing that happens is that information gets just lost in plain sight. I mean, there's just we're drowned with facts about irrelevant things, and so the really important kernels of it have to be, you know, aren't connected. So, for instance, we all know about one raid, that one night raid that happened on May 2nd, 2011. We know everything about that raid. The raid that killed bin Laden. We know how many SEALs were on the helicopters. We know what the helicopters were. We know what kind of guns they were carrying. We know that they had a dog with them that was a Belgian Malinois named Cairo. We know everything about that raid. But that same year, in 2011, there were 30,000 other night raids in Afghanistan that we know nothing about.
I think also since I started in journalism in the mid-90s to the present, we've seen a real erosion of journalistic integrity. We have kind of an infotainment society, and where the sort of news programs are starting to more closely resemble entertainment programming, and everything becomes this big reality show, and it really distorts what's really happening in the world. Every time I go on cable television, you know, it's a really bizarre experience. I mean, it's a totally fake world, and it feels like you're. I don't even like doing it anymore. I mean, there was a period. It was a period where I was on cable TV a lot, but it doesn't feel like real journalism. I mean, the people I respect are, you know, there's a young journalist named Austin Tice who's missing in Syria right now. He was a Marine who turned into a journalist, and he's been missing for months and months and months, and his parents are trying to find him. And there's, you know, this was a record-setting year for journalists being killed, and yet the foreign budgets of all newspapers, and newspapers are under siege right now, they're going down. They're slashing foreign budgets. Someone like Ted Koppel, you know, who used to have news as a serious commitment on ABC News, you know, got boxed out of the equation and, you know, not on the scene anymore. Dan Rather, you know, who was also a great journalist, who was a big corporate journalist, but was a great journalist covering foreign conflict, has been sort of marginalized in the cable news world. And most of the journalists doing this kind of work are unfamous journalists. And the whole media apparatus depends on stringers now and wire services, which means local people doing this reporting. So I think we pay a price as a democratic society for allowing journalism to sort of crumble away the way that we have. I think we're going to look back later and say we made a huge mistake in this era by allowing advertising-driven content to rule the day. Mm-hmm. It doesn't serve a democratic society to not have a vibrant media culture, to not question the wars we're engaged in. You know, this isn't about Democrat, Republican. One of the things in our movie is that there's sort of a continuum from Bush to Obama of this specific policy, and we have to rise above that. But in order to do that, people are suffering in this country. My parents are nurses. My mom's pension is pitiful when she told me how much it was when she retired. People are struggling. It's a big ask to say, oh, care about Yemen or care about Afghanistan. But if we don't have a media that provides information that enables people to make informed decisions, then we're not doing our job as journalists. I put myself in that category too. All of us should be working harder to provide that service to the American people, because without it, we're not really participating in democracy or democratic process.
Well, it seems to me that even the shows that on the cable shows that do talk about Afghanistan every once in a while, and not just about, you know, fashion, that it all becomes about American politics and this perspective, and not actually what's happening in Afghanistan.
Yeah, that's a great point. Very good point.
Yeah, I mean, every time that I came back from Iraq or Afghanistan, I would come back and think, okay, it's going to be the only thing that anyone is going to be talking about. I mean, there's 200,000 American soldiers on the ground here fighting a war. And that is going to be the issue of the day. And you'd come back and it would be nowhere. I mean, you know, embedding with soldiers, I mean, they don't care usually what your politics are at all. They like want someone to be paying attention to the war that they're fighting. I mean, but all we hear is, you know, silence.
You know what I think is amazing is with this string of school shootings, you know, which are horrifying. One happened, you know, an hour away from New York City where we live, the Newtown, Connecticut shootings. And, you know, it was a complicated story for journalists to cover. And I think there's a real critique to be had of sticking cameras in kids' faces and some of that. But what I think is so moving about it, and I remember this too from the Virginia Tech shooting, is you know the names of all the victims. You know their stories. You know the dreams that were snatched away from these kids. And we saw it. I remember the Virginia Tech shooting moved me deeply to hear about teachers barricading the door with their bodies. You hear these stories. And because journalists did their job in reporting on the human costs of it, we're starting to have a real debate in this country about guns in our society. If the same was true for these wars, if you actually knew the stories, and it wasn't just, you know, an airstrike killed 34 people, including two Al-Qaeda members, who were those other 32 people? Mm-hmm. If we were allowed into the homes of those people and they became real to us, then I think we'd actually have a debate the way we are now about guns, about war policies. And so in some small way, that's what we're trying to do with this film, is to make it real to people so that there are names and faces attached to the policies. We don't have the answer to this, to what should be done. Or there are people in the world that want to do harm to the United States. But we aren't having a real debate. And it's not serving a democratic society not to understand the human costs of it. And that's the fact that our film will be shown and has the chance, we don't know that it will, but has the chance to make some of that real for people is the whole reason we did it. Yeah.
Well, you know, it's hard to imagine that a significant percentage of Americans know how many people were killed in, or how many Americans were killed in Iraq during the war, much less how many civilians in Iraq.
Yeah.
It's just not, you know, even that's too much for us to actually remember.
Of course.
In this society, which is a shame. I mean, it's stunning when you think about how many bodies came back from that war.
Exactly.
Kind of like lost, much less to actually empathize with Afghanis.
Right, right. Yeah, no, I mean, you're absolutely right. And it's,
I mean, this whole war on terror, it's the longest war in American history. It's a war that's killed hundreds of thousands of people. And it's a war that we don't talk about, that we don't know about, that's, you know, that's systematically hidden from us. And so, you know, it's impossible to have a real national debate about this war when you know, it's being conducted in the shadows and no one gets to see it.
So it's hard when, like Eugene Jarecki was here last year and is actually still working on the film, The House I Live In. And, you know, for him, that's a war that's been going on for an awfully long time and nobody really cares. Until now, it's beginning to infringe on America, on white middle-class kids. And now, you know, he's hoping that something will come of it.
And he's been doing this great thing of taking his film into prisons, too, which is, I mean, it's really, I mean, that's a great film and a great project and a real, I think it's a model for how you spur debate, but he's fighting an uphill battle with it too. How can you ask Americans to care about that unless it's affecting them personally?
But he committed to not working, you know, basically. He stopped making documentaries for the moment because he made one every year for a few years.
Right.
And now he's, you know, he's trying to be an activist
in
that regard. But that's the thing. How many of those things do you, the thing with the gun violence you were talking about, because we turned it into a reality television show, because here are all these really great stories, important, you know, intimate stories, all of a sudden it matters, and then, you know, 3 weeks from now something else happens. It's very hard in this culture to get anything to be sticky. And I think the NRA actually said to somebody in some interview that their main strategy is to just to stretch this out as long as they can.
Yeah.
And everybody will forget.
I mean, look at the guns are just selling like hotcakes, you know, the specific guns too, the AR-15, because there's this perception that the non-American socialist president of the United States is going to be personally coming and seizing their weapons. I mean, we're living in a time when reality television is sort of, you know, everything that happens on sets of Bravo or, you know, shows or whatever, and then everything else is kind of the chatter in the background. And, you know, I mean, I actually think, though, that film, we're in a different era with film. I mean, you mentioned Jarecki's film. The Invisible War has started a huge debate around the issue of rape in the military that is so central. Gatekeepers and Five Broken Cameras both are, you know, incredible films that are telling part of a story that, you know, is very central to U.S. politics and becomes a major issue in the elections, and yet I think there's very little information about it. So, I mean, we're just honored to be in the mix with, I'm not putting us in those categories, I'm just saying we're honored to be in the mix of films that are really taking on big issues in a way that conventional media, you know, have kind of dropped the ball on it.
So as journalists, it's now been over 10 years for both of you.
Yeah.
Is there another act that is not about this, that is, you know, okay, we're now the next stage, we're going to put on a tie and become a White House correspondent, or, you know, whatever that is? Or
if that ever happens, I want you to personally come and, like, yank me out of wherever I am with that tie. Can I get a commitment from you?
I will commit to that, yes.
All right.
I will show up in D.C.
Okay.
And
please yank me away from
yank
whatever.
Yank directly away.
Whatever party at the vice president's residence I'm in, just yank me away, because that's pretty much what they do, is party there.
So I guess you're not taking over Al Gore, you're not going on current TV to, maybe with Al Jazeera.
we're actually very excited about Al Jazeera Americas. I mean, Al Jazeera gets this weird reputation, and it's still perceived as like a terrorist network in some sectors of American society, but it's one of the
Obama News.
But it's right. Exactly. Yeah. It's one of the best media outlets in the world. I mean, it's an amazing place.
And progressive. I mean, that's the thing that's so funny about it, is that I've been watching Al Jazeera English on my iPad for years.
Yeah, they have a great app.
Yeah, Harry Shearer actually turned me on to it. He said, that's the show. That if you want to watch a program to get real news, that's the place to go.
Right.
And BBC next, and then maybe start considering American networks.
Yeah.
After that.
It's the only global news network that isn't headquartered in Europe or America, right? That it really is global. I mean, it's very, very serious. And it really covers the wars. I mean, I've made actually a lot of short films for them from Iraq and Afghanistan, because they were one of the only networks that had a desire and appetite for that kind of coverage. Like one summer, I made 3 half-hour docs for Al Jazeera from Iraq. There's no network in America that would care for right. that much, you know, coverage of this most important story at the time for, you know, for Americans.
So fighting, continuing to be in war zones and amongst the heat is really where you're heading for the next, at least another 10 years?
I'm going to be heading for a bed sometime soon, I think, after this. I think once you have it in you, it's hard to imagine either of us moving on and taking a desk job somewhere. But I think definitely we both learned a lesson. I mean, we went through, I can't emphasize enough how close we became from covering this together. We both had a kind of collective experience. We know what it looks like to have your life shattered by not taking care of yourself and not allowing yourself to process everything you've taken in. Mm-hmm. And I think both of us are going to try to do it differently this time, and and process it, talk about it, you know, make sure that we keep our health going forward so that we can do that stuff again. But I don't know what's going to happen.
So you don't want Malkovich playing in the biopic?
I mean, I'd be honored, but I don't think there's going to be a biopic. I think, I think we did this, and this was our life for a number of years, not just the 3 years of shooting, but everything before that. So, you know, I'd love to be able to tell you what we're going to be doing a year from now. I have a feeling that we're going to go right back to what's familiar to us both.
And your heart's there. I mean, my question is really not just about whether CBS is going to ask you to be an anchor, but it seems like you guys are still, after going through all of this and very tough times and very, you know, intense things, that you're still committed to going out and fighting that fight and not just getting some perspective.
Yeah, definitely.
I mean, we started covering the Iraq War because we felt like it wasn't being covered enough. Someone needed to go and be unembedded and be on the other side of the whole military and media kind of structure. And we're not the only people who could do it, but we were at that time the only people who would. like take that risk and go and be. I mean, for years,
we know everyone because it was a small group of people who were unembedded. The journalists were unembedded. Yeah. It wasn't that
a tiny group of people who were the only Western reporters who were unembedded in places like Iraq, you know, covering this. And so, I mean, I still believe that kind of reporting is essential.